Hello and welcome to The View from Mayor Brown Podcast. This is a fortnightly podcast series for employment lawyers and HR practitioners which highlights developments in case law and legislative changes of importance to UK employers. It's presented by Nicholas Robertson, the head of Mayor Brown's London employment team. This podcast is available via iTunes, YouTube and the Twitter feed Nicholas Robertson, Twitter handle at NicholasRobert11. It is also now available on Spotify, Google Play and Yahoo. The time spent listening to these podcasts can count towards your continuing education requirements. And at the end of the podcast, we will explain how to get in touch if you wish to claim credit for continuing education purposes or if you have any comments or questions.
Hello and welcome to podcast 178. I finally got there. I finally got to the one on handling collective consultation during lockdown. In all seriousness, it's going to be one of the sadder consequences of the coronavirus pandemic that most employers are going to have to look closely at whether or not to make significant job cuts to current headcount. As I said on a previous podcast, some employers rightly will look at this as an opportunity to recruit staff or promote staff and beef up particular areas they think are key going forward. Most employers are going to be heading in the other direction and scheduling necessary, sadly necessary, headcount reductions. Given that there are more than 7 million people currently on the furlough scheme, that's doubtless concentrated minds wonderfully at the government, which I'm sure will be why the coronavirus job retention scheme has been extended until the end of July in its current format and is then being tapered rather than having a cliff ending after that. Presumably some of the government's thinking is that some employees' jobs may be saved and some jobs may be moved to part-time working, and to the extent that there are job losses, these will be scheduled over 3 months rather than one horrendous month. All of this, of course, will ensure that employers will be tempted to consider how collective consultation under Section 188 of TOLCRA will apply in the current circumstances. Similarly, other employers are looking to restructuring contracts of employment, and as we know, if employers are introducing adverse changes and are even contemplating the prospect that staff who decline those adverse changes voluntarily might be dismissed and offered re-engagement, then that would also trigger an obligation to consult under Section 188. The government's recent announcement that the furlough scheme is to be progressively wound down from 1st of August may also trigger a need for some employers to go through a collective consultation process sooner rather than later. Some employers will have furloughed staff on the basis that the employer was willing to accept they topped up 20% and were content to reclaim 80% of the salary being paid to employees and get that from the furlough scheme. If the reclaimable percentage were to go down, say, to 60%, some employers might in turn look to reduce the salary paid to the employees so that their contribution remained at a top-up rate of 20%, i.e. leaving the employee on 80%. Anyway, what I've got to say now is, it applies equally to collective consultation focused on job losses, redundancies in the ordinary sense, or to changes to contract employment. First up, is it possible for the employer to conduct legally compliant collective consultation exercise under Section 188 in the current circumstances? Answer, yes, but it's not going to be easy. Look, employers are going to be concerned. In practical terms, it may be extremely difficult for them to consult in a legally compliant manner with employees who are either in lockdown and who are either not working at all or they're working remotely. And there's obviously a subset below that of employees who are currently on furlough. How do you consult with them without taking them outside the furlough scheme? Well, the basic legal obligation is to consult with employee representatives of affected employees and to provide certain statutory information to those representatives. It's not necessary to provide all of the information, Section 188, to the representatives before collective consultation can start. We know that from cases such as Akavan. Indeed, an employer may well pass the trigger point for initiating collective consultation at a stage when it doesn't have all the necessary information. And in the light of cases such as Akavan, it's clear that even if the employer is genuinely unable to obtain some of the statutory information because of difficulties caused by the current working conditions, the lockdown, whatever, that does not excuse a lack of consultation. Imagine circumstances where the employer is unable to identify the number of temp staff working in the business because the person with the relevant information is currently absent by reason of illness. That does not excuse, it's not a reason for deferring collective consultation, it doesn't excuse it. Secondly, there's nothing in the collective consultation process envisaged by Section 188 that requires face-to-face meetings between employee representatives and the employer. This applies whether one is talking about collective consultation or under general principles for unfair dismissal, individual consultation. If the employer neither has a recognised trade union in place for the relevant classes of employee at risk of redundancy, nor has a standing employee consultative committee, it's going to be necessary for it to elect, to enable affected employees to elect employee representatives. That ballot must be secret, but it's not necessary to have a ballot box with physical attendance at a ballot box to drop a piece of paper into it in secret. Arrangements can be made for a secret ballot to be conducted online. It's necessary to consider the culture of the company in making any arrangements for online voting. I recently was asked to advise a company where there was a history of voting on things like pay rises. And both employer and the union were very reluctant to step away from traditional ballot box voting. Voting on key issues was something that culturally within the company was viewed as utterly taboo. People did not speak even to each other about how they had voted. And so neither the union nor the employer were happy about the idea of having an online alternative, which they felt might be viewed by some as opening up the possibility that the way they voted could be known. So if you are looking at this, it's obviously important to respect the culture of the particular workplace where the redundancies are taking place. But such exceptional circumstances aside, the point is there is nothing inherently objectionable in a secret ballot being run online via a third party, such as the Electoral Reform Society or an independent third party. The one further thought I had about electing employee representatives, if you are in the stage where you are electing employee representatives, generally speaking, the employer has considerable leeway in terms of how it identifies the constituencies and how many representatives it has. There needs to be adequate coverage and the representatives need to be able to represent their constituents effectively. Those are my terms, but that's the sort of underlying principle. But subject to that, if we're going to be doing online collective consultation, then I'd have thought something that keeps the number of representatives down as far as possible may be hugely attractive, rather than, as sometimes happens with face-to-face meetings, you end up with far too many representatives. And in a face-to-face meeting, that's not the end of the world. It might be quite challenging in a set-piece online collective consultation meeting. The other point about collective consultation, the employer's got to provide access to the employees who are going to be represented by the employee representatives, but nothing is said about that having to be access in person or face-to-face. So overall, our view is there's nothing in Section 188 which would render remote collective consultation with employees or their representatives as inherently in breach of the legislation. What about furloughed staff? Because I said they were a subset. Well, that's the background, of course, is that employees are not supposed to earn income for their employer or carry out any work or provide services for their employer, according to the employer coronavirus guidance note. However, the guidance note does provide that union representatives, whether they are official or elected, are able to carry out representative duties if they are on the furlough scheme without therefore rendering themselves ineligible for the furlough scheme. Similarly, ACAS have said that individuals can participate in their own disciplinary and grievance hearings without being taken out of the furlough scheme. On that basis, we think it's very likely that employees are able to stand as employee representatives or participate in redundancy consultation without taking themselves outside the scope of the furlough scheme. Because the alternative would be mad. The alternative would mean that employers were in effect unable to make redundancies whilst an employee was covered by the furlough scheme. And we know that's not the case from what's said in the employee furlough guidance note. The alternative would be that employees on furlough were deprived of the ability to be consulted with prior to the dismissal, which is hardly likely. So on that basis, we're suggesting that employers may wish to frame any invitation to a meeting, whether it's collective consultation meeting or an individual consultation meeting, in terms of an invitation to attend rather than a requirement to attend. This is probably being a bit cautious on our part, but to the extent that the employer is relatively relaxed whether the employee attends a collective or individual consultation meeting, I think there's little to be lost by such an approach. One point to be aware of, however, if a staff body is being elected for the purpose of a collective consultation exercise, it's going to be necessary to ensure that furloughed staff are made aware of what's happening, made aware that they can stand as representatives, and made aware of their right to vote for their choice of representative. What about the practical issues that the employer should consider before and during remote collective consultation? Well, our view is that at the first consultation meeting, or indeed as a preparatory meeting, the employer and employee side should meet to discuss how collective consultation is going to operate remotely. It's not exactly unknown for collective consultation meetings to become quite feisty. So in the circumstances, it can be hard enough to follow several different angry conversations taking place at the same time when everyone's in the same room. It's impossible to do so on a conference call. It would be sensible for the employer and the employee representatives to agree a protocol or etiquette for running collective consultation meetings. If this is agreed up front, then there's a far greater chance of preventing the breakdown in communication, which can often then lead into legal claims, hardening of attitude on both sides, and general fractiousness. I think employers should also bear in mind that employee representatives, and in particular trade unions, may be very concerned about their ability to interact with the employees they are representing. It may be appropriate to invite the trade union or employee representatives to talk about these concerns, because an employer who facilitates that access may be facilitating the collective consultation exercise too, to its own longer-term benefit, as well as the benefit of its staff. Clearly, the precise practical issues to be considered before conducting collective consultation will vary from employer to employer and exercise to exercise. I'm going to talk about some of the issues, but the golden rule is really discussing the issues in an open fashion with employee representatives will enable the parties to try and come up with an understanding about how this is going to work for the particular location, for the employees concerned, in the particular circumstances. And underlying this, of course, employers are under an obligation under Section 188 to provide appropriate facilities to employee representatives. The issue of what amounts to appropriate facilities for employee representatives is, in my experience anyway, rarely discussed. But in the context of a business that has traditionally done collective consultation on a face-to-face basis, moving to do the meetings remotely, well, what are appropriate facilities? This could be much more important. Will employers have to provide secure and secret conferencing facilities for meetings with employee representatives and their constituents? What about meetings between the employee representatives themselves in preparation for consultation with the employer? What about costs incurred by employees dialing into such calls? Employers may find they're being asked to pick up the costs for such calls, as it would seem unreasonable to expect employee representatives to pay for the privilege of being an employee representative. There'll be many such practical points to consider about the assistance that should be offered to employee representatives. Equally, if the employer is operating in a culture which tends to do meetings face-to-face rather than remotely, many employees may be unfamiliar with video conferencing and have no facilities to enable video access from home. That would mean that conference calls would be limited to audio lines only, unless the employer felt it was appropriate to offer a choice, with some people dialing in but others choosing to join by video link. Now, employers have to think about how those calls would work. To just take one example, if the employer's side, or indeed if the employee's side, were going to be relying on documents as part of a presentation or statement of proposals, that would probably need to be sent through before the meeting, as otherwise information contained in a document which is being waved around on a video call will have little or no impact, certainly none during the audio call. Conversely, One of the other aspects of online meetings which I think employers should consider is just how easy it is to record such meetings without the other participants being aware of this. Obviously, employers need to be aware that sidebar conversations and comments made on the assumption that what is said will remain within these four walls. Well, you can no longer make that assumption, can you? But it might be worth considering whether the employer and employee representatives would agree that a meeting would be recorded, and then employees who are going to be covered by that consultation could watch the meeting itself. I am sure that some employers will recoil in horror at this idea and be concerned about employee representatives playing to the gallery. But if recording is entirely feasible covertly, this may go on without the employer realising it in any event. Obviously, of course, if the employer raises it and the employee representatives agree that no recording should take place, the employer will be justified in feeling extremely disappointed if covert recording did happen. But in general terms, the courts and tribunals have been relatively hands-off when it comes to admitting any such recordings into evidence. If there is a subsequent dispute and it's relevant, well, I strongly suspect a recording will be allowed in. So at the very least, employers need to be alert to the fact that whatever they say in negotiation meetings could easily be recorded and passed on without the speaker being aware of it. We also consider employers should look at making online collective consultation meetings shorter and potentially scheduling more of them during the requisite consultation period. Generally, many people find that online meetings and video calls, particularly for those unfamiliar with them, are much more tiring than in-person meetings. Secondly, it may help employee representatives who are being asked to attend collective consultation meetings if they are not being required to give up a significant portion of their day in one go. Consider, for example, an employee representative who is also responsible for homeschooling for his or her child. It's likely to be far more productive to arrange two shorter meetings dealing with specific topics than one longer single meeting. It'll also send out a powerful message to employee representatives that the employer is trying to accommodate them rather than bulldoze them. We've been looking predominantly in what I've said so far about collective consultation, but the employer conducting remote collective consultation also needs to think more carefully than normal about the process of briefing staff about proposals and the progress of collective discussions, that sort of hearts and minds exercise that is always essential. Uncertainty or rumour are destructive at the best of times, so employers need to think about how they will communicate in a timely fashion with the wider group of staff affected by the proposals, and then also those not affected by the proposals but who might be worrying that similar measures might be applied to them down the line. Is postal communication sufficient? What about if emails are not available for all? Will everyone get postal, or will some get post, some get email? Is it acceptable to use both forms of communication, but meaning then there'll be a time lag for some people? If staff are not working and so are not logging into work emails regularly, will it be possible to schedule updates at a given time so that people know to log in to look for the update? Perhaps collective audio calls or videos might work. An employer who's aware that many of its staff have English as a second language will also need to think carefully about how effective remote briefing will be, because you may be familiar with a situation where announcements are made to a group of employees and those whose English is weaker benefit from sitting from a translation or explanation from someone whose English is stronger sitting next to them. That won't work in the same way in an online consultation. So the employer needs to think about ensuring that more documents are generated, setting out its proposals and any exchange of information with the employee representatives, and then that those are then translated perhaps into the appropriate languages for the relevant employees. If it comes to individual consultation which is being done remotely, then clearly there are a lot of potential benefits to allowing employees to be virtually accompanied into any of the consultation meetings. Some employers currently allow this, but others do not. Indeed, I think if someone is in lockdown or working from home, it may be that employers just have to accept that a family member can be permitted to attend. In practice, the employer is not going to know who is off camera or sitting next to the individual but just out of shot, or who's sitting next to them on a phone call or conference call, prompting the individual. So it may be better to accept the inevitable and involve the family member too, rather than have them off screen and therefore more difficult to engage them constructively to try and address the influence that they're having. Next question. Is it possible to argue that coronavirus is a special circumstance excusing collective consultation altogether? Well, I think the short answer to this is it's very unlikely that the pandemic by itself would amount to special circumstances. Courts have taken a pretty restrictive approach to special circumstances, and as a result, I think there would need to be something else added into the mix before it could possibly amount to a special circumstance excusing consultation. If, for example, the coronavirus pandemic brings about the demise of the largest customer of a business, and as a result that business goes into administration or liquidation without any prior warning, triggering redundancies there, you might have a special circumstance because it's all unexpected. But in truth, the proximate cause of the redundancies is the insolvency of the business and not the coronavirus pandemic itself. And we've got existing case law on that. In any event, don't forget, even if special circumstances exist, the employer is still obliged to do whatever it can to comply with its collective consultation obligations. So I really think that's most unlikely to lead anywhere. Does the news that the furlough scheme is going to wind down at the end of July, does that effectively trigger collective consultation obligations for employers now, many of whom will know that the winding up of the furlough scheme is likely to bring job cuts? Well, Section 188 requires an employer to consult where it is proposing collective redundancies, and the directive uses the term contemplating rather than proposing. A number of cases have considered whether there is in truth a distinction between whether the employer is proposing or whether it's contemplating redundancies. And in the UK coal case, for example, we seem to be more towards the contemplating end of the scale than the proposing end of the scale, if I can put it that way. Other cases have insisted that there is no difference between when I'm contemplating redundancies and when I'm proposing redundancies, which I think doesn't really square with my understanding of the terms. But anyway, the way I've tended to look on this as a practical issue is that employers have to acknowledge that there's an increased risk that they're passing the trigger point at the point at which they're starting to contemplate redundancies as one of a number of potential outcomes. Clearly, the winding up of the furlough scheme is going to mean that many employers are starting to run numbers, if they haven't already done so, and contemplating redundancies. Does that mean, therefore, they must now immediately embark on collective consultation or risk being in breach of legislation? Short answer to this is, the employer is not in breach merely at this point if they haven't commenced redundancies and they're in the planning phase. The statutory obligation is not a requirement to consult as soon as the employer is contemplating or proposing redundancies. Many years back it used to be, but that wording got changed. The obligation is now an obligation to consult in good time once the employer has started contemplating or proposing redundancies. So in many cases, provided the employer allows sufficient time for collective consultation before any redundancies take effect, and provided it does not reach any firm decisions before collective consultation starts about what it is going to do, then it does not need to start the consultation merely at the point when the trigger is reached. There could be a risk, there might be a change in the surrounding circumstances, which means that the employer's ability to consult collectively has been compromised by the delay. To that extent, the employer is on risk, but in our experience, in most cases, provided the employer avoids creating the impression that it has made its mind up and the delay is about putting the finishing touches to plans that are going to be implemented in their entirety unchanged, well, then the employer will often defer the commencement of collective consultation. Often, and I think rightly, employers prefer to go into collective consultation with well thought through proposals. That's not the same as a decision in all but name. There is a danger in starting collective consultation too soon. It's not a legal danger. Trade union employee representatives are unlikely to bring legal proceedings saying the employer was consulting too soon. But the difficulty is a practical one. Collective consultation may get bogged down. Employee representatives may get frustrated if the employer has clearly not thought through its plans and they do not inspire confidence. If it doesn't have details at its fingertips in response to the sort of self-evident questions that are going to be put by employee representatives. Well, so I think overall, my take on it is that collective consultation and individual consultation is going to be more difficult for employers. But if employers plan thoughtfully to address this and allow for the involvement of trade unions or employee representatives in considering the practicalities of the situation, there's no reason why collective consultation and individual consultation cannot be legally effective and, more importantly, be seen to be fair by the workforce. So, thanks very much for listening. I hope everyone continues to take good care of themselves. And, well, I don't know what I'm going to be doing my next podcast on. I strongly suspect the government will have some more coronavirus guidance, furlough update stuff for us. And that's what it'll be on. But failing that, who knows? There have actually been a few new cases that I'd quite like to talk about as well. So maybe we'll do a non-coronavirus podcast yet. Take care, everyone.
So that concludes this podcast. We hope that you find it and others in the series helpful. If you have any comments or questions or want to know how to claim continuing education credits, please email Nick at nrobertson@mayorbrown.com. Thank you for listening to the podcast.